It's also emanating from right of life, etc. Ladies and gentlemen, I have told you, inform you very briefly, how judiciary and social activists have played very important role in the growth of this regime of transparency, in regime of giving information to the citizens of this country. I can tell you that this is of course about India, but globally there has been about more than 80 plus countries, or maybe now 90 countries, who have adopted Right of Information Act and with different nomenclature. And you will be interested to know that perhaps first act, which was called Press Act 1766, was passed by the Sweden government in Sweden in 1766, which provided the citizen right to know everything or anything without assigning any reason. And same thing, of course, is now given a citizen that he can ask information, he or she can ask information without assigning reasons. There are many, many judgments which I can quote, which are available to me, but I will stop here and I move on to my another point. Why we should be very happy about this right of information in this country? Why we should be very happy about this regime of transparency, or regime of, say, as Kani Zahra said, accountability, which has come through Right of Information Act, when already, as I said, constitutional pronouncement or judicial pronouncement by Supreme Court, etc., etc., were already there? I will here quote you Mr. Wajahat Habibullah, then Chief Information Commissioner of Government of India. And he said, "The right to information opens the doors of knowledge to the people, necessarily the ultimate custodian of power in any genuine democracy." Now, he is linking up right to information to the essential part of a democracy. It allows the public to see what government at every level is doing on behalf of citizens and with their money. Transparency is crucial to accountability, what Kani Zahra has just told you. This is what Wajahat Habibullah has been telling us. The principles and rights available under law, on laws on freedom of information, buttressed by judicial pronouncement, provide a powerful reminder that the purpose of the government is to serve the people. Now he is attaching a purpose to the government, that the government should serve the people, and that the right to information falls squarely within the fundamental rights which we have just discussed. I am quoting you another Commonwealth Human Rights Initiative or activist, Indrajit Mistry, and he said that the country, the act has the potential to crack down on the corruption on a nationwide basis. Now, this is another thing to be happy about this act. One is, as Wajahat Habibullah said, the part of democracy, and as now Mr. Mistry is saying, it can be used to crack down upon the corruption. Now, you can very well imagine how corruption or removal of corruption is important for our good governance, which has been explained to you by my predecessor. Now, lack of providing information has, over a period of time, resulted in a deficit of trust between the administrator and those who are administrated, between the public servant and the public. I need not to reiterate or highlight this point. We all know how much is the deficit of trust between us and those who govern us. We do not trust a single act, what to say, act, we do not trust a single word of our political leadership, of our bureaucracy, of our policy planners, etc. There's a huge deficit of trust. Now, if we share information, I think this deficit of trust can be reduced. So the right of information is very important for removing this deficit of trust, which will contribute towards the good governance and, of course, as rightly pointed out, social development, social progress, and so on and so forth. Ladies and gentlemen, Information is the most effective right in the hands of a citizen to ensure efficient and good governance. In fact, absence of information from such institution has caused lots of misuse of resources by the holder of such information. The glaring case, in example which I would like to quote here, only one case, there are many, many cases. The glaring case, in example, the secrecy maintained by the Swiss banks. They are not telling us about the accounts which people have, how much money they have, how much is accounted for, how much is black money, and there's a huge politics in the country and huge political fallouts and fall of governments and fall of ministers on this particular point, that is lots of huge amount of our black money or Indian money is stacked in Swiss bank. Now there's a secrecy around that and we do not know about that, and rest you can see yourself what is happening. So you can understand that the lack of information, how it can affect the governance and the deficit of trust which I have just talked about. But there are lots of examples which I can quote and which you can also find out on website of various agencies. But I would like to briefly mention you that there are quite encouraging results of use of right of information. One such response was observed during a one-day national convention on right on RTI, its caption was "Right to Know as Right to Life: Citizens' Voices." So there were citizens' voices, and this convention where lots of persons from the weaker section, from the lower part of the society, they were called and they narrated their own stories, they narrated their own experiences, and this all was documented in the form of I will not say a book, but in a form of a publication. And I have taken a lot of examples from there. This convention took place in 2009, where civil activist Smita Patkar was also present. Kabir, a social NGO, was there. Social Watch, another NGO, was present. Chief Information Commissioners were present. Bureaucrats were present. So in the presence of media, social activists, information commissioners, bureaucrats, many of these persons narrated their own stories of success. The main objective of the convention was to focus on the use of RTI as a tool of good governance in the hands of common people. The convention witnessed participation of people from backward areas and heard their stories of successful utilization of right to information to solve their simple problems. Now, many stories are there. There was one gentleman named Mazloom. He was a rickshaw puller in Madhubani district in Bihar. The Gram Panchayat sanctioned him 25,000 rupees under Indira Awas scheme. And he kept on begging and pleading for 3 years to get this Indira Awas money. But whenever he went to officials, they always demanded a bribe from him. And then he met some social activists and they used RTI. And by the use of RTI, ultimately he got his money. Another person who narrated is Pani. She came from a very poor and illiterate family from Bhartwaj village in Chitrakoot. And when they found that these children in schools are not getting uniform, which is to be given to them by the school, they use RTI. This was the case of 27 illiterate ladies who used this RTI and ultimately managed to get uniform for the children of the school. Another name is Kunal Mochi. He was a daily wage worker in Patna. He worked as somebody's form, and when he went back to ask for his money, he was threatened for life. He lodged an FIR in a Harijan court, but no appropriate action was taken. In the meanwhile, he came to know about right to information and reached the office of RTI Manch in Bihar. With the help of activist Virinder Singh, he questioned the police under RTI, got the information, and ultimately action was taken on his FIR, etc., etc. Ramdar, he was in the Bidari village of Uttar Pradesh, and he narrated his own story of how successfully he used the RTA, etc., etc. Bhanumati, a Barai district, she also narrated her story of how she achieved the desired result in the RTI. Kanhaiya Azad Bhokar, Ambika Chhatrapati, Altaf Ansari. This Altaf Ansari stays in Firozgarh, Madhubani district in Bihar. And he observed there was a madrasa running in his village. 5 teachers were appointed, but there was no students. The situation initiated him to take action. And he, along with people of the village, talked to the principal of madrasa regarding this matter. The principal was not ready to cooperate and said that the working of madrasa was his responsibility and nobody else is required to interfere there. Then this gentleman used RTI application, got information about the madrasa, the grant madrasa is getting, etc., etc. And ultimately an inquiry was set up by the Department of Education and the corrective measures were taken. Ladies and gentlemen, with these success story, I must tell you there are threats also. There are threats also, and there are incidents reported where we use the word whistleblowers. Whistleblowers are under pressure, under threat. They are murdered. We have stories from Bihar. We have stories elsewhere. The story is no different when an RTI activist, Satish Shetty, was brutally murdered in Pune, or Vikram Lakshman Dodia, a Surat-based shopkeeper, was killed for refusing to withdraw his RTI application. Or Tamil Nadu police snowballed RTI queries on IPS officers' assets. MCD officials in Delhi allegedly threatened RTI applicants and so on and so forth. There are a number of such stories which are coming to us where whistleblowers, activists are threatened. We keep reading such stories in newspapers, and there have been lots of studies and lots of reports which I am skipping. I am not going into that. But the only thing I want to tell you that is a very potential tool in the hands of a citizen where he can question the government, ask for information, insist for transparency, and consequently accountability. This is one of the important part of the good governance. I will not go into other aspects of the good governance. Of course, other speakers will come and talk to you. But only I want to tell you the experience or experiments arising out Right to Information Act, how it came into existence, and how it has been effectively used by people at the cutting edge level, at the execution level. We talk about the scams. We talk about that building scam in Bombay, Adarsh building scam in Bombay. We talk about many where RTI has been used and information is being used, and forcing the government to take corrective measures. Now, finally, I tell you, ladies and gentlemen, that the Right to Information Act is a new law, of course, to this country. But of course, as I told you, there has been a history of some progress. In 2005, when this law came into existence, I was in UPSC. And before the law came into existence, the bill was circulated to all of us. We all were asked to offer our comments on the bill. Now, in UPSC, we all, without any single exception, I can say with some authority, we all felt, what a nonsense law. What a foolish law. How can we work under this law? And UPSC formally met in a commission's meeting, formally requested the Government of India to exempt UPSC from the purview of Right to Information Act. We failed. The Government of India did not accede to our request. This is not my story. This is not the story of UPSC. Mr. Bhalerao may perhaps agree with me. Most of us in government service felt this law will not let us function independently, will not be able to write notings in the file independently. What will happen? Somebody outside will come and question us, why you have taken decision, why you have not taken decision. But ladies and gentlemen, I must tell you, this law has come to exist in the statutes of this country. It's not going to go away. Twice, Government of India tries to amend this law. Twice, the cabinet passed the amendment bills. Twice, during the regime of the previous government, if I am correct to remember. Twice, cabinet passed the bill to amend the act, but government did not find courage or enough support to take the amendment bill to the parliament. There was so much hue and cry in the newspapers, in the media, in the, among the social activist persons, or the people who are conscious of the right of information, of fundamental rights, of human rights, etc., etc. What I am trying to say that any one of us who is scared of this act must understand, must realize, must tell ourselves that we have to work with this law. And as I told you, there are stories and stories and stories and stories of success of this law. Is going to become stronger and stronger and stronger. If you follow the judicial pronouncements or judgments given by Chief Information Commissioner of the central government or the state government, you will see that the ambit of the act is expanding. Earlier, according to act, it's applicable to public authority. Now, public authority is well defined the act. Now, definition of public authority, I'm giving one example. There are many things which I can talk about. But the definition of public authority is increasing, 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 and increasing. And by and large, now everything is coming under the ambit of this act. Just to give one example, India International Center at Delhi is a trust which is run by a group of trustees. Now, somebody asked information from India International Center. They said, we are a private organization. We are not a public authority. We are not supposed to give information. The petitioner went to the court, CIC, and of course, it is the court. The court says, you got land from the government at a cheaper rate. So you are substantially funded by the government. Since you are substantially funded by the government, you are a public authority, and you are supposed to give information. This is just one example. Now, many private schools, so these two examples will make my point to understand that the ambit of public authority is increasing. Nobody tomorrow, even a private company, can say that I will not give you information, because public companies, private companies come under the purview of Companies Act. If they come under the purview of Companies Act, they are under the extended definition of public authority. The point I am driving at, that all of us change our attitude, which is essential, which we as a government servant had initially when the Act came into existence. All of us has to realize that this Act is a very important tool for good governance, for democracy, for all those things which Kani Zahra has mentioned to you in her presentation just before me, and therefore we have to acclimatize ourselves with it. Two important examples of good governance which flow out of the Act, I will quickly mention it to you and then I'll conclude. One is, the Act itself says that all the information should be placed in the domain of the public, suo motu, on your own. You need not to wait for somebody to come and ask information. So the one of the responsibility on the public authority is to give information on suo motu, and we have to put it this on the website, notice board, booklets, etc., etc. One of the important component of this activity is that all the information should be digitized. Now this one digitization exercise, which will be the outcome of the Act, which is given in the Act itself, that the public authority should make all efforts to digitize the information available there. Now, digitization will lead to e-governance, and I need not to elaborate that e-governance of late definitely is a very important component of good governance, where of course efficiency, responsiveness, corruption-free atmosphere will come. Now, another thing is that this Act bounds us is to organize our information. And organize our information means good record management. Anybody is from public administration, anybody from for government service or government experience or any administrative experience will know a good record management is essential for managing the institutional knowledge. Institutional knowledge sometimes goes away with individuals. If I go away from this office, I'll take away all the knowledge with me. If somebody else goes away, he'll take away all the knowledge with him. Now, if I institutionalize this knowledge, even if I stay or I go away, the knowledge will remain in the institution, whether it's about decisions or orders or rules or anything else. So institutionalization of knowledge is one of the important components of this Act, which is again an important element of good governance. These two examples I wanted to give you, that how this Act, apart from transparency and accountability and check on government and participate in the government and using by the cutting edge people and implementation of welfare schemes which I have just narrated, this can help in the e-governance as well as the institutionalization and formation. Finally, ladies and gentlemen, I must tell you, this is a very unique act. The only act in the books of institute of this country where personal responsibility has been fixed on the officer for non-compliance of the provisions of act. No act of this country, no law of this country put personal responsibility. If a CPIO, a public information officer, does not provide information, he will be personally responsible. The institution will not be responsible. He will be fined. And the fine, as Supreme Court in many cases, and in the case of registrar of Banaras University, the registrar was fined. The university wanted to pay. His court says, no, it's a personal responsibility. Registrar has to pay from his personal pay. So therefore, this only act which imposed the personal responsibility on the information officer. I cannot take a plea, now my boss says so, my rule says so, the policy says so, it's my responsibility. There's no law which has put responsibility on the individual, whether it's any other law, name it any other law. So one of the major significant contribution in the judicial or legislative history of this country, which this act has brought in, where Supreme Court, despite many efforts, could not succeed to impose personal responsibility on defaulting officers. If an officer, or if somebody, you keep asking, so-and-so arrested them as a terrorist, so-and-so arrested a police officer, arrested them as a terrorist. After 10 years, they have been not found guilty and relieved. No responsibility on a police officer. No responsibility of the investigating agency. But under this law, if something goes wrong, if the CPIO does not perform his duty properly, he will be personally held responsible. So, ladies and gentlemen, there is a lot of potentiality. Of course, there are risks also, as I said, like whistleblowers, etc., etc. But there is a lot of potentiality in this law, and we must make use of it. Let me conclude with the words of Gopal Gandhi, former governor of West Bengal. He said, right to information should not become right to bullying. It should not become right to bullying. He aptly quoted Mahatma Gandhi from Young India issue of 30th December 1926 that those who seek justice, I am quoting Mahatma Gandhi, those who seek justice must come with clean hands.